You just tuned into the Whatever Bro podcast, featuring Fall River's own Joe and Scotty. Get ready for hilarity, vulgarity, and sound guy Jeff, with funny man Justin Crofton. Brought to you by 59 Media. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas on Whatever Bro. You've got Justin and Kirby. They're snuggling under the tree. Jeff's got mistletoe up his asshole. Scotty was also making eggnog for the studio. It made us a little sicker, so we settled for Justin's liquor. So let's drink his wine. Welcome to episode 34 of the Whatever Bro podcast. There's no mayor on today, so I guess you can say it's all downhill from here.
Yep, that was the highlight of our life.
Yeah. Guys, welcome to a special Christmas edition of Whatever Bro. we got Kirby in the studio.
Hey,
We haven't seen her for a solid month.
Yeah, we miss Kirby.
I'm back.
Hey, yeah. Baby, we met. Your hair looks beautiful.
Oh, thanks.
Gorgeous. Gorgeous.
You know, she had the hat on, and then she was just like, my hair looks too beautiful to have this hat on.
A little
on
too point. Fabulous.
Yep. Damn right.
Awesome. Justin, how you doing? I like your attire.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I hate Christmas. I can't stand it. It fills me with a boiling rage, actually.
Yeah, does anybody here actually, like, truly enjoy Christmas?
I like hanging out with the fam.
Get up!
My family's cool. I don't like going to church or anything, but you know, I do it to make the mom happy.
That's I like Mariah it. Carey Christmas album.
That's
yeah.
it.
That's it. That's about the only part.
Yeah. It's all about Christmas. But like on Christmas though, you don't like chilling with the fam and
yeah, for a short period of time, eat some food and that's about it.
See
yeah.
you later.
Mm-hmm. The whole like the buildup of the Christmas is just terrible. You know what I mean? I think when like you said, when you're there like with the family,
yeah,
on a Christmas Eve or on a Christmas Day, but like the buildup. Of man, you're trying to rush around to get fucking gift cards when it's just a stupid idea.
Yeah, the, you know dude, I mean? The shopping is really horrible. I've resorted to just getting everyone a gift card and a bottle of liquor. Special. Everyone, even the kids.
Yeah, you're a special kid, Joe. Yeah. Very creative.
I don't know if I ever told you guys this, but when I was a kid, my parents were in a religious cult, so we never celebrated Christmas.
This is the Church of God?
This is the Worldwide Church of God.
Yep.
And you can find that on cultwatch.com, which I swear to God, I'm not making up. It's a real website.
Why did they celebrate Christmas, though, if it was about God? They didn't believe in, like, Catholic.
Well, they were this particular wacky cult was, like, they followed the Old Testament in the Bible, the first part of the Bible, like, the really stupid part.
Yeah.
This is the part of the Bible where it's, like, kill gay people and don't wear clothes of two different cloths, like, that far back.
Oh, man.
So yeah. They were intelligent enough to follow that line of reasoning.
Shit, that's not good.
It doesn't sound very up to date.
No. So they thought, according to the Old Testament, that Christmas was a pagan holiday. So every year they went into, my brother and I were in the same class, so they'd go to our teacher every year, never fail, and say, the boys don't celebrate Christmas, so when you guys are having a Christmas party and a celebration, just stick them in the corner and give them some construction paper.
Wow.
So, wow. So to me as a kid, anytime Christmas came around, it was just dread and horror. And you know how understanding children.
Dread, horror, and construction
paper. Yeah, exactly. No, it was me, my brother, and like the one Jewish girl just shoved in the corner. And it was always like, all right, who's ready for a Christmas party? And the kid's like, fuck yeah. And she's like, oh, wait, sorry, guys. Let me get the Jew and the two freaks into the corner here. Here's your fucking pencil and construction paper.
Do your parents now, like, have they...
Oh, now they celebrate. They like, are in another form of Christianity, which is... Right.
Another branch?
Yeah, another branch.
I think they owe you a shitload of presents and parties.
Absolutely.
Yeah. How long were you deprived?
I think until I was old enough to just stay home from church, so probably, like, 13...
So all the golden years of Christmas.
That's why I think I really hate Christmas with a deep passion.
Yeah,
because you fall in love with Christmas as a kid.
Right.
And I always hated and feared that time of year as a kid. Because you know how understanding other kids are.
Yeah.
They're like,
who's that freak in the corner?
Yeah, yeah, I know.
Yeah, what'd you get for Christmas? Well, nothing. Part of a religious thing. Oh, you're a freak, you mean? Yeah. Yeah. That pretty much sums it up.
My mommy says not to answer the door to you people.
It's bad enough at a certain age we realize Santa's not real. I was really disappointed. I was like an older kid when I finally realized.
What did you say?
Santa's not Santa's not real, Scott.
Hold on a second.
Shut up.
You must be playing. So there's that. There's that. But like, that's if you didn't even have Christmas, so you didn't even have to worry about believing in Santa. Like, did
you? No, my parents early on said Santa Claus is a lie that parents tell children.
Wow. So have they ever like apologized to you for that? Like,
no. They're just like, well, you know something? We learned a lot. And I'm like, all right, well, that's how you're going to play it, huh?
You ruined my childhood. Oh, thank you.
Yeah. So fuck Christmas is what I'm trying to say.
You did say you were excited, though, because like now at Christmas, you actually have something legitimate to talk about since we interviewed the mayor. Like you said, like now you have conversation to go to.
Well, I don't remember saying that because I was pretty drunk by the end of that interview.
Yeah.
I don't remember. We were talking about this off air. I don't remember like from the halfway point on. But
yeah.
Ultimately, I think it was a great interview.
Well, it was. Was it not? Have you had a chance to watch the whole thing?
No, I did watch bits and pieces. I don't remember much of it because I just wasn't paying attention to anything he said.
Were you just zoning out when he was talking about transitional docking and other exciting?
Honestly, it wasn't even – the guy is super smart and knows what he's doing. I just don't give a shit about politics and honestly couldn't follow. So I just kind of like was drifting. But the dude's not boring. It's just I don't –
Yeah, you're just not interested in a lot of the policy shit.
Yeah, he actually got pissed in the, in the elevator. We got in the elevator with him and his posse there. And what did he say? He said something like, something about voting. And I was like, nah, I don't vote. And his eyes lit up. Like,
yeah. Well, he kind of grilled you on the air about the voting.
Right, there too, yeah. And I was in the elevator. He was just really like not. He just was, and I'm just like, I don't, in a nice way, I was like, I don't really give a shit.
Yeah.
So,
with all due respect, I don't give a fuck.
So, you want to go to ground level or are we going to one? Because I'm out of here.
So, you're going to the lobby, right?
I thought, because again, I don't know anything about, prior to that, I didn't know anything about Forever politics except that one mayor tried to shoot another mayor.
Yeah.
Allegedly. Yeah.
Which I wanted more of the details, but he wasn't going to.
Yeah, he was good.
He was cool about it, though.
He explained it, though, in a nutshell. Did.
Yeah, he explained a good amount. He is a politician, though, so he was good at kind of, like, you ask him a question that he doesn't want to answer. He does a little dance, a little shimmy.
It's a great dance, though, because he doesn't sound dumb when he does it. He kind of just talks around the issue.
Yeah.
Right, and by the end of it, you think he answered the question, but then, in retrospect, you're like, wait a second.
Where have you gone?
Yeah. He just manipulated.
It was just a
me.
Magic trick.
Where have you taken this?
But it was, I listened to it.
It was great.
Sober after the fact. And it was pretty interesting, his plans for the city and whatnot.
Absolutely.
And he's a sharp guy, sharp as a tack.
You can tell a man in his position kind of has his back against the wall. Like, you have a lot of people that are on your ass. So I could tell at first, like, even before we were on the air, I could tell it, like, he was, like, holding his own, kind
of
like, oh,
ready to punch one of us.
What kind of questions we talk? Like, it was just minor stuff. If I was the mayor, I'd be asking the same questions. I'd be like, what are these guys asking me? Am I going to get just like ganged up on? Because he doesn't know us. We all know each other.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to goof around every week. He doesn't know what to expect when he's coming in here. For all he knows, we can just be like, hey, we're going to ask you about your personal life, the gun stuff.
Dick pills.
Dick pills.
We always talk about dick pills
live
on the show.
It's on the air. Yeah, there's a lot of viewers.
It's a big deal.
Yeah, and he's got high stakes because like he said, he probably has political enemies watching this.
Of course.
Oh, yeah. Every mayor does. There's always someone who hates
even Mayor McCheese from Ronald McDonald's Playland.
He does.
Grimace is all up in that ass.
I wanted to just bring something up that I think Kirby heard about as well. The thing at Diamond High School. I don't know if you guys heard about this. Yeah. I don't know. Somebody sent me a text message. A friend of mine, Sarah, sent me a text message. Said, hey, if you want to talk about this on the air, usually when you get those text messages, it's like, Jesus Christ, this is horrible. She gave me something awesome. This girl, her name is Marissa Farias.
Mm-hmm. And just saw this.
Check this out. So she said, as most of you know, my brother is gay. He's been all of his life. He's very confident about it.
This is Joe's sister? Oh, no. I'm sorry. Keep going.
This is when people comment and go, Justin, shut up.
I just interrupted Scotty.
I want to see how many times he interrupts
I'm
me.
I'm sorry.
This is only going to take like 30 seconds.
I'm going to get wine.
We'll keep tally on our notebook.
Yeah, that's one.
So the kid's gay. He's a high school student. He had a project at school. Ed Diamond, to build a colorful, creative. He built a colorful, creative gingerbread house with his classmate, who is also gay. So this gay kid, another gay kid.
How old is this kid? Do you know?
High school. So
high school. Okay.
Anyway, I think he said he was a junior. So maybe 17.
All right. With his classmate, so Joshua and his friend came up with this gingerbread house, which is adorable. By the way, I seen the picture.
Not
fucking
bad.
Badass, dude.
Yeah. Awesome. Really? I saw it. Yep. Awesome gingerbread house. Right.
Are we talking like a huge gingerbread house?
It looks. It's regular size.
It's just fancy.
You know what? Can we hold this up to the camera? This is the gingerbread house they built.
And that's not icing.
It looks like it, but it's not.
So that's the
yes.
That's man. Right,
so that's
man icing.
So that's, you got a good idea what it looks like. All right. And it's obviously adorable, creative. Once it was time to display their work, the teacher was disgusted with the rainbow colors and told them, and I quote, "Don't be surprised if you come back tomorrow and this is in the trash." Now listen, this is one person saying it, so you don't know the whole story.
Yep.
It sounds a little, I don't know. So don't be surprised if you come back and that's in the trash, and continue to criticize their work. The following day, the teacher addressed the entire class, and this is where it gets fucked up, and said, "If you feel the need to express yourself and your diversity, we have clubs for that."
Wow.
And this girl said, "I'm outraged that a teacher treated my brother and his friend that way. He had no good words for the project, didn't even want it to be displayed with other kids' work. The kid went to the office and complained, but nothing was done or said to the teacher. How can a teacher who works with diverse high school students, especially in this day and age, all day knock down my brother's hard work because it's too gay?" If that's true and that dude said that, like, "Oh, we have groups for that."
He should be fired.
Fucking shame.
Was this
on
him. In the papers or anything? Or
no.
Nope, this was just a post.
Okay. This just happened, right?
Yeah, so we only have that side of the story. But it sounds like we're dealing with a teacher who is
intolerant of gays, mm-hmm. which or is probably much more than gays.
And yeah. From what I creeped the comments on that a little bit the other night, and most of the high school kids who commented on it, there were no name drops of, well, there were thousands of comments, and I did not have time for that. But most of the kids who were commenting on it were like, "Yep, know exactly who that was. Believe it. Absolutely, this isn't the first time that's happened." And granted, like you said, we only know one side of the story. He very well could have been talked to. But
true.
That's not going to change his viewpoint. That's not going to way he can change the way he conducts himself in a classroom.
And can you like the thing here is like, out of all members of society, a teacher is somebody who should be totally cool with that and
it's
promoting.
Supposed to be one of the people that you can confide
yes.
in.
That's what's the horrible part
being
about
a 16, 17 year old.
Yeah,
that age is terrible.
Absolutely. Yep. And to be open at that age in high school, you know how many kids are probably fucking with him? I mean, yeah. I don't know how it is. Back when we were in high school, it was you got made fun of a lot. I think it's a lot more accepted now, but still, man, as a teacher to do that. And the gingerbread house was dope.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Fucking what? So
how else are you supposed to make a colorful gingerbread house without a rainbow?
No
and
shit.
Gingerbread houses are quite difficult to make.
Yeah, dude.
They are not easy. I've tried many times.
So was that in a class or was that in a shop that happened? Because I know Diamond's shop weeks in class.
I think it was the culinary
probably was. Yeah, like culinary class. Regardless, so, fuck that guy if that's the truth.
We need to find this teacher and have him on. I want to hear his side.
Yeah, I would love to. Hey, if you're listening,
and
come
then
on.
That way, if we don't agree with it, we can bash him on the air.
Yes, literally with a hammer.
Let's look for him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and demand a public apology.
Seriously want to. They probably won't come on though.
I would love to.
They probably wouldn't.
I'd love the guy.
We can get the kids on.
Yeah, if the guy doesn't want to come, we'll
that
have the
would
kids.
Be good.
Does That'd he have to be over 18?
Yeah, good question.
What, to be on this?
We ain't licensed. According to who? Yeah.
Like, I'll make up a permission slip.
Yeah. We ain't licensed.
I immediately thought, like, are they too young? Or,
it's
like,
just a Facebook video.
What's the law?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, no. I'll make up a permission slip. It'll be fine.
So if anybody knows that kid or the teacher, they want to come on, and obviously not the same time, but if they want to come on and tell a story, bring it on, man. We'll give everybody a fair shot.
And bring that delicious gingerbread house.
And if you're in the culinary class, I love to eat.
We'll eat the whole thing.
Delicious
live on the
treats.
Well, yeah. And like, oh, so he doesn't like gay people, huh? Fucking asshole.
This gay house tastes delicious.
Yeah, so, you know, people watching, make it happen, man. Get them on.
Well, my guess is the guy is probably like, he's probably on the a few years away from retirement.
Yeah,
he's probably
oldest.
He's probably old school.
Yep.
And Diamond was kind of famous. I remember when my brother went there, it was kind of famous for these real hard dudes. old school, hard headed guys.
It's a good point. Especially, I bet you it's an old guy.
Yeah.
Who doesn't care really.
That
so
was
he's
my
like,
first.
I didn't think about that.
Head,
it's like a Vietnam vet.
Yeah, he's
know?
Like, yeah, fire me. I don't
care. Not that it's an excuse, but if you're brought up that way, you're going to turn into that type of person.
Yeah, yeah, it's tough.
Yeah,
it's tough.
In a way, there's no excuse. No excusing this teacher, but in a way,
okay, goes Justin's point. Yeah, yeah. There we go.
I can almost feel bad in a weird way for the teacher. Okay, so I'm picturing this grizzled Vietnam veteran, right?
Who's fought for our country.
He's beat Charlie to death with his bare hands for this country, right? His best friend have died in his arms. Now he's a shop teacher at fucking Diamond, dealing with all these shithead kids. And he's like, he was raised in an intolerant time.
he looks at the gingerbread house like, fucking quiz. Yeah.
He still has a fucking crew cut from Nam, right? He's still just got high and tight.
He's got the POW license plate.
Yeah. He's got the tattoo, you know, all the Vietnam tattoos. Yeah. Flaming forces. Death skull, special forces. And then these kids are like as gay as I can imagine.
Yeah.
They're flittering around with like the jimmies, like sprinkling them, like, we're making a gingerbread house.
He's not
motherfuckers!
Just listen,
my friend died in Vietnam for this.
This kid takes the angle, and actually, I side with him. Right?
Yeah, fuck that gingerbread house. I've turned a corner on this
what's
subject.
What's funny about this is that's very possible. That he is a grizzled old war vet. Right.
I killed Charlie with my bare fucking hands for these fruitcakes to make a gingerbread house, and my job got like. I'm not saying that's my opinion.
Justin's making me hate gay people. Yeah.
No. That's not my opinion, but you can see how like a guy like that would kind of think like
he's
that.
Yeah, he's probably just a very old school guy. And it's not an excuse, but
right.
But is it?
We get it.
He killed Charlie with his bare hands. That's my my stance on that.
You know? We get it. We're on your side, Professor.
Carried his brothers off the battlefield just to see this gingerbread house.
Right, exactly. He was shot in the buttocks.
Oh, shit, bro. That is hilarious, dude. I haven't laughed like that.
His first question when he was looking at the gingerbread houses, where's the American flag?
I said colorful. I meant red, white, and blue.
What country is this?
I died for the American flag, and now I'm trying to buy American flags. He said that.
Yeah.
Not me.
Jeff said it. Jeff said it. Oh, wow. That's good.
Well, yeah, that's a...
But we do love gay people.
Yes, we do. Right.
Mm. Oh, no, I love gay people.
We're pro-gay.
This, imaginary Vietnam vet shop teacher in my head doesn't like him.
I can't get it out of my head.
What would be funny is if he wasn't in the military.
I was going to say he's like 28.
Yeah, he's a student teacher. Yeah.
He's like secretly gay himself.
Yeah. Yeah,
but like,
hey, that might be it too.
That happens, dude.
Yeah.
That movie?
American Beauty?
Always sticks in my head with that old. Like, pretty much the picture you just painted.
Like guy. Dude. That's probably where I subconsciously get that whole plot from. Yeah.
He hits on Kevin Spacey, is that it?
Yeah. He, like, despises, like, homosexuality. He's this big military dude. And that movie, when I saw it for the first time, that came out of nowhere. He actually goes up to him in the rain, and he thought his son was doing gay stuff with Kevin Spacey.
Yeah, and all throughout the movie, he's like, these fucking fags, am I right?
And it looks like he's going to go over there and, like, kill him. Yeah. He fucking kisses him. And Kevin Spacey's like, I'm just trying to work out. Yeah.
And if you're watching the movie for the first time, like, what the hell?
I was, and I've only seen it like twice, and I was just like, whoa.
And then he killed Kevin Spacey after that.
He did, that's right.
At the end of the movie.
Yeah, because he rejected
spoiler.
Him. And had, yeah.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah, if you haven't seen that movie from 20 years ago.
I know. They also show, I believe, a 16-year-old girl naked, and for some reason it's okay to masturbate to.
It's because it was art.
Mm-hmm.
She was playing a 16-year-old girl.
Yeah, right.
Ah.
Come on.
That's when you can get away with it.
You can still masturbate to it.
Yeah.
I think.
Shit, you ruined it.
Okay. Yeah.
I thought she was actually 16.
Right.
I just ruined it.
Oh, shit. Oh, I want to congratulate Jeff real quick. The Free Your Geek podcast hit almost 7,000 views.
Woo!
That's competing with our numbers. Jeff.
Absolutely. That's big time, man. For a geek nerd type of show.
Yeah, man.
Can you please promote that right now?
Yeah. Can you guys hear me okay? Because I'm on the
a little bit, yeah. Just talk
I'm
close.
On the ghetto mic.
It's good.
Yeah, no, it was good.
We give Jeff the ghetto mic.
We got the ghetto mic. It's cool.
We only have
four mics in studio, so I got a handheld right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was really cool. Basically, our newest, our second co-host, Don, was on there too, and we basically just started talking about Star Wars Rogue One that's out. And yeah, it got a lot of shares, lots of shares, and We by the end of this week, it was almost 7,000.
Fucking views, awesome, dude! Yeah. How's that?
They had that's legit.
Huh? We actually, KB and I were actually talking. We want to have another movie show and have you back on.
Absolutely, man. So, absolutely.
So they had like Darth Vader set up. They had a Yoda. Like the decorating is on point. Like if I'm scrolling on Facebook and I see all these figurines, and
you
shit,
like Star Wars,
I'm gonna click it.
Absolutely. So that's awesome, dude. And I know you've been doing a lot of promoting for it. And it's what, every other Thursday?
It's every other Thursday, but we're gonna be doing a Rogue One review this Thursday. So
oh, okay. Free Your Geek podcast.
Free Your Geek, yeah. Find us on
YouTube, Facebook. Geek,
yeah. Moving on up.
Cool.
Good thanks, for you, guys. Man. Good
to
for
the
you.
East side.
It'd be funny if Jeff keeps getting more and more successful and we just try to rip off his formula, but no one knows anything about the subject. Like
we do the same podcast, but we have Darth Vader right there.
Right, yeah.
Darth Vader seemed to have worked.
Oh, there was something I wanted to bring up, actually. I was doing some research today on some kind of like natural stuff. Obviously,
like herbs?
Yeah, like medical marijuana. You know how that's coming into play. There's dispensaries that are going to be in Fall River. Have you ever heard of, and I'm going to ask Justin especially because you know kind of about this stuff. Have you ever heard of CBD oil?
No. Correct me if I'm wrong, but the CBD oil is not psychoactive. It is like a byproduct of marijuana, but it doesn't have the psychoactive effects, right?
Correct. Correct. Yep. It's in marijuana, but it's like not the THC. So the THC is what gets you stoned.
Good for kids that have seizure disorders, right?
Correct.
People with MS, stuff like that.
Anxiety, depression, which is why I was looking at it. And I've heard like I did some YouTube videos and stuff. And I think from what I heard, all you got to do is get like a doctor's, literally like a doctor's note. You don't need a prescription. You need a doctor's note to say, I think this is a good idea because it's so... It's so not like it's just like a bot. It's for your body. It's so natural.
Mm-hmm.
But it's some people with anxiety and depression have taken it and been like, my anxiety has been reduced.
Wow.
So I'm going to try and check it out. And
I've heard great things about it. And I'm not sure about the current laws, but I believe now you can just walk into a dispensary and buy it. Correct me if I'm wrong.
I don't know. You might be right. What I heard was you just need a doctor's permission. So you can't just walk in and get it. You need either a medical marijuana card or... From what I heard, you literally lead. It's almost like a fucking, like the doctor says, yes, I think this would be good for my patient. And they'll give it to you. But I think it's in the works to be totally, totally legal. That's CBC.
As it should be.
Fuck yeah.
CBD oil, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. Yes, yeah, CBD. Yep. And that is, and again, it's not THC at all. So my problem is I have like severe anxiety and depression, which I've obviously been dealing with a lot of people know. But when
premature ejaculator, just
always,
just throwing,
always, yeah. Thanks, Just.
No, I just want a full listing
of all my
fucking listing.
Problems.
I want the whole medical listing.
All symptoms.
What the hell was I saying before? I know, yeah, you got me thinking about
premature ejaculator. I want to bring it back to boner pills. That's my issue every time.
Oh, now, wait, that's Joe. Can you tell? That's funny. What you heard about someone said, that's hilarious.
My ex-girlfriend hit me up. By the way, she listens to the podcast, which is hilarious to me because now I'm going to be paranoid of everything I say. She was like, I saw your friend at CVS getting a prescription, and I actually heard him say, I'm here for the Viagra. Like, you know, when you go into, like, if you or I go into CVS,
yeah.
It's like, yeah. Viagra.
It's those pills.
Yeah.
He's just like, Viagra, the boner pills? Damn mine. Don't let this
guy
take
good for you. Them. Good for you because I hate it when they're like, I feel that the pharmacists, they're like pretty callous in protecting your privacy when you're there to get pills.
Yeah.
They're like, all right, it's almost like I feel like they're sometimes like line cooks. Like, what'd you order? Like, what do you want?
Yeah.
And you get a huge line behind you, and you're like, Viagra. Yeah. What? Yeah. I have erectile dysfunction.
Well,
Viagra.
The key is to be comfortable in your own skin. So that's, everybody knows. I'm like, but I thought when you said that, I don't know if it was me, because I'm like, I haven't got a prescription for that for like a month.
When
like,
she told me that, I was like,
it's gotta be Scotty.
This has to be true. It has to
well,
be.
I've been in CVS so much lately for either the dick issue I went through and now like dealing with anxiety and stuff. I'm in CVS like every day and I'm like, all right, what's this kid got? I've literally been in there for a month. I've had eye drops.
Mm-hmm.
I've had lotions. I've had pills. I've had.
You have like a frequent buyer's
bro,
card or anything?
It's I literally bought everything in CVS pharmacy.
They have a coffee mug with Scott's name right now when he waits it by the pharmacy there.
Dude, I swear to God, man. And but I remember a month ago I went and I got a prescription from my doctor for Viagra because I like to take them sometimes. And she said.
I like the Flintstone vitamins.
I like the way they taste.
Yeah, I like to take them sometimes. I like their color.
You know, it tastes good, guy. Don't chew them, though. Not good. she, I remember the girl said to me, it's just so funny how, why is it the one time I'm getting Viagra is the time they're like, I don't see anything here for you. Yep. What are you here for? And like a normal person would probably be like, it's, you know, the enhancing penis thing. And I literally, dude, there's people all over there. And I was just like, the Viagra. Is my prescription for Viagra ready? Four pills? And people, I just don't care, you know?
Yeah.
You
I get nervous.
Good for you.
I get nervous when I buy condoms. If I'm just going like going to Target for
condoms. Wait,
condom,
dude, why?
What's that?
What's a condom?
Condom?
A condom?
What?
Only sailors use condoms, I think.
No, you should feel cool about that because, first of all, it lets people, like, if chicks see it, they're like, oh, he's banging girls, and he's protecting himself.
When they scan just the condoms, I look at them like,
you know where I'm going.
Wink. Yeah. Same thing at, like, I went to a walk-in one time, and I had this full, like, body rash, and like,
this is why you should use condoms.
Well, no. Here's, like, the, ultimately, it was allergic to,
latex?
The detergent.
Oh yeah.
So anywhere that like you wear tight or clothing, like for example your feet, because your socks are tight. My feet were like a mess. Yeah. My dick and balls.
Because that's the moist area.
Yeah, because you got a box of briefs on, so they're right up in there.
Yeah.
But anyway, my dick is a mess. Like my feet, my whole body. And I go to the walk-in, and they're like, "All right, what's your problem?" Like a full waiting room. I'm like, "Oh, I got a body rash." What? What was that? Can you speak more clearly, sir? Everyone, you could hear a pin drop in that waiting room, and I know every motherfucker.
This is like old people with newspapers.
Oh, they're all listening. They're all listening.
Hang on, let me turn out my hearing aid.
Yeah, let me turn this up. This guy's got serious problems.
Right,
exactly. He's whispering. Oh,
honey, this is gonna be good.
Right. Yeah. So, I just feel like these medical people and pharmaceutical people, they just fucking. They do not give a shit about your privacy. You know?
Yeah.
They probably don't even realize it because they do it every day.
Exactly. Yeah, right. I was just going to stick out. I worked at a pharmacy for 6 years, and let me tell you.
Part of the problem.
Sorry. Let me tell you there. I have some stories I could tell. But at that point, you deal with 90-year-old people all day long. So you're like, oh, what are you here to pick up? Oh, it's the round one. It's the round white pill. Ma'am, you are on 17 different medications at this point, and 13 of them are round. What do you want?
Yeah.
What are you here to pick up?
My grandson.
So when you show up at the pharmacy at 4:30 on a Thursday afternoon, pretty much all they're thinking about is, God, I can't wait to get out of here and go to the bar.
You just want
to
whip their dick pills at them and call it a day.
I don't give a fuck about your dick pills or your $50 copay. Swipe your card or you're not getting a boner, all right?
You must have seen some shit, huh?
Oh, it was good. It was very good.
You got any crazy one you want to share out of all of them? Anything like...
Oh, no, I do have a good one.
All right, give it to us.
We actually still laugh about this to this day because I still talk to a few friends that I worked there with. And there was a girl who came in the pharmacy and she wasn't there to pick up a prescription, nothing. But when people have issues, they come and they think the pharmacist knows everything. So she comes... I want to say Fall River's finest just because that's, you know, like a tagline sometimes.
Yeah.
But I didn't work in Fall River, but it was one of the surrounding towns. And a girl came in, no lie, swear on my son's life, feety pajamas. No. Leopard feety pajamas. Walks
Strike
in.
One.
Yeah.
Big time. Red flag city.
Yeah. Walks up to the pharmacy counter, high off her train. I'm like, can I help you? She's like,
Oxycontin.
And that's what I'm thinking. I'm like, all right, what gauge needle do you
want? Yeah, I was going to say syringes.
They're 27 cents. How many do you need? And she goes, what would you recommend for vaginal odor?
Oh no way.
Out loud? Like,
no, out loud.
Nice and proud about it.
So,
my God.
I just turn around.
Did you say suicide?
And okay. The pharmacist that was working at the time.
Excuse
me,
ma'am. My pussy
well.
Smells. Can you,
And he was a young, strapping male, this pharmacist. And I'm like, you got to take this one.
Yeah.
No.
Just for entertainment.
I'm sorry. I'm just a mere technician. I'm just a peasant here. I cannot give you any advice for your vaginal odor.
Miss, what do you use?
How do you get the smelly veg juices away?
Yeah. Now, did you direct her to Glade plugins in aisle 3?
Oh, God.
It was between that and the loofahs.
Yeah. It's a potpourri.
We have shower gel. would help.
I got too much cheese on my taco. So here's the thing.
Sorry.
Silence. You really silence derailed it with that.
I totally destroyed the
vagina
cheese, taco.
Cheese joke.
Oh, man. Oh, so, I did have a, at a CVS, I'm walking in just to like, get some random shit, not even a prescription for anything. And this guy is like, hey, what's up, bro? I got, like, I have the car down there. My aunt, she's having a seizure.
Red flag. She's red flag. Like run. Run for your life.
She's having a diabetic seizure.
I need $25.
I need to get syringes, but they asked for ID. If I give you money, can you go inside and get...
Syringes?
Yeah, you need an ID.
Oh, my God.
Get syringes for him. All I need is syringes. He actually gave me money. I like an idiot, took it, and I was just like...
You're trying to figure out what the scam is. Like, no, okay, gave me money.
I thought I'm gonna go in there, not ask, and then be like, oh, they ran out, and just give me money back.
Okay, yeah. Good move.
Yeah.
I go in there. I actually talked to the pharmacy people about it. I'm like, do you guys ask for ID if people come in here and ask for syringes? And they're like, no. Yeah. Like, depending on...
Usually we do. Yeah. Well, you're supposed to. You're supposed to be 18.
Yeah,
but
I think they just
if
fucked
you
up.
Look 40 and, like, you've been doing drugs for the past 30 years, I'll give you whatever. Do what you gotta do.
He said he had gone in there and asked them, and they refused him. So then my first question was, did a weird bald guy come in here asking for syringes at all? And they were like, no. They asked the whole place.
Yeah.
He hadn't even gone in there because he knew he wasn't going to get them.
Right.
So I kept his money. I was like, all right, I'll take care of him. But just so you know, there's a weird crackhead outside or whatever.
They're like, of course, this is CVS, sir. We know. It's a weird crackhead outside of every CVS.
They were surprised. They were like, yeah, he comes around.
You
the
have the regulars.
Right now,
it's like, yep, it's all that one again. Yep.
Yeah, that's Fred.
Don't worry. He's going to come in with medium coffee. don't worry about him. We'll call the cops.
I give him his $20 back. I'm just like, oh, man, they don't have any that particular size.
He wanted a specific gauge?
Oh, yeah. They are particular.
Oh, my God. A specific gauge. And I was like, they said they ran out. They got to wait for the next shipment. What?
Ooh, good one, Joe. Yeah.
And he was a prick
pat
to
on
me.
The back.
He was just like, oh, you know what? Whatever. And he took his money back. But he did fucking walk away. When I first talked to him and he was pointing to the car about his aunt having a seizure, I was like, where?
Right.
I'm looking at every single car and there is no woman having a
seizing.
Seizure.
Right.
There's no woman seizing.
I'm pretty good at seeing seizures and I don't see any. I'm not visually seeing.
I'm a pro at seeing seizing.
she sells seizures by the seashore, if I remember correctly. Now, have you guys had it with like these horseshit
hate 'em
drug stories of like, guy, my family? Ugh. This guy told me this a couple months ago. And he even said station wagon, like that would endear me more to him. Like he was a family man.
Yeah, living.
He's like, bro, and first of all, it's like, it's 1:30 in the morning. I'm going to a Bank of America ATM, like one of those, you can just scan your card and go in.
Yeah.
And he's like, bro, my family's in a station wagon around the corner. Right?
Does it have one?
I don't know why, but that's super hilarious.
It's the word station wagon.
It's that one fucking detail where it's like, I do not believe you. You're clearly lying to me.
Yeah, like he could have just said they're in the car.
Yeah.
He's like, it's a station wagon with the wood grain on the side.
And that's exactly how I pictured it, with the wood grain.
Yeah, the old school.
But you know, he was probably so proud of himself over that line, like, I'm going to say station wagon, and I'm going to be like the family man.
Pats himself on the back.
Yeah. But it's like, I'm so sick of those lines. I swear to God, the next time that happens to me, I'm just going to go like, stop.
Yeah.
I know you're a heroin addict. I know there's no family in a station wagon. Here's a dollar. Like,
I know.
Please don't insult my intelligence.
It's funny. That happened to me recently too. And I knew this girl was trying to get money. And she was like, my baby's at home. My son. She didn't look high, but you know she needed to get high. And she was just like, I was going to a liquor store and she's like, oh yeah, my son and blah, blah, blah. And I honestly felt bad. I wanted to be like, you're a fucking liar. But I just was like, nah, I can't help you. And she's like, all right, thank you. But it's just like, it's crazy how desperate you can be when you're on drugs. Like you'll sit at I can't believe like the woman, she wasn't like a fucking junk boat, dude. That's what thing. It's like,
not
at that moment.
Yeah. She didn't, it was just, she was so desperate that she would sit outside and ask strangers and give a fucking bogus story for $10 or $5.
I hate the bogus story. Just legit be like, hey, I have no money. I'm not even going to try to make up a story. Like, I'm struggling. Can you spare $5? In a case
like
that.
Oh, my God.
I'd
100%.
Like,
yes.
I'd be like, you know what? I'll give you fucking money.
Like, the guys, every time I go to a sporting event, whether it be the Red Sox, the Celtics, the Patriots, well, there's not much panhandling at the Patriots, but like Boston, anything like
Boston
that.
Boston a lot.
People who have the signs that say want money for beer in food.
Word.
Here you go.
Boom. Word.
Yep. Take $5.
I love beer and food.
Yeah. You know right.
I mean? I get it.
I like beer and food too.
I get it. Yeah.
Just take my money. Have fun with it.
I swear to God.
Who am I to judge? If I'm going to give you your money because you say that you have a starving puppy, or if you have, or if you want beer and food, I don't give a shit.
You know what's the
funny? Either way, I'm giving you money.
You know what's the funny part is when you see, you know, you see the panhandlers or a homeless guy who sits at like the corner at the red light, and they're fat. It's like, dude,
how are you doing this?
Smoking a butt, and I'm like, them things are expensive. I'm like,
with all the miles you walk,
like. You
and all the money you don't have to buy food. How are you this fat?
Yeah, dude. There was a guy that used to hang at Dunkin', and he was fat. This guy was so homeless, bro. He was disgusting looking. But he's fat as hell. And I'm like, bro, like you are succeeding awesomely.
He probably lives in a dumpster behind McDonald's.
He eats all the leftovers. Yeah,
he gets all the Big Mac remnants.
Right behind Cinderella Bakery. You know, the pop sex from the day.
That's the place to be.
This guy literally survives on pop sex.
Hey, if I had the option, sign me up. Please, ma'am, can you bring a stick of butter outside? Maybe some Keishon Josh.
You eat it like a candy bar?
Yeah. Oh.
Ooh, margarine.
He lives in the dumpster, but he just keeps his mouth open like a baby bird. So as they throw the old stuff in, he just kind of swallows it down.
It's got to be, because how is he so fat?
I know.
It's like that show Lost, the guy Hurley, if anyone's seen Lost, there was a big fat guy.
And he stayed fat.
Yeah,
and the fans always said, how is he so fat on that island?
Yeah.
You know? Same thing.
Yeah.
He did not lose a pound. They were on that island for a long time.
He got fatter, if anything.
It's a plot hole. Yeah. It's definitely a problem.
Crazy.
But I was in Providence recently, for whatever reason, I was going to a 7-Eleven. Oh, my friend wanted cigarettes. And there was a homeless guy outside, and I literally couldn't even hear him. My brain sees these people, and it just goes, no.
See you later.
Ears Mine shut too. Off. Yep. And he went like, bomb, bomb, bomb. And I just said, listen, I don't have any money. And he goes, I asked you for food. And I was like, oh, I felt so bad. I was like, oh, fuck. I've become like so callous.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, dude, yeah, I'll buy you food. Like, no problem. So I bought him a few slices of pizza. But
like, I thought you said you didn't have any money.
Yeah. Right, right. Well, I have a card. That's what I always tell the homeless. Yeah. Like, oh, I just got a card.
I don't carry cash. Yeah. That's what I tell all of them. Sorry, guys.
Do you take debit card? I can swipe.
Do you have a Square on your iPhone that I can just swipe?
even funnier, he had like something set up.
Imagine that.
Dude.
It's like, actually, I do.
Just Venmo it right to here. Me. It's fine.
You want your receipt?
I guarantee you.
I take PayPal.
That's funny, and I guarantee you it will be a reality
in
a few short years.
I'm surprised it hasn't happened
yet. Yeah.
They all have smartphones.
Yeah,
right.
And I'm generalizing saying they all, but...
Wow. You homeless racist.
What do you mean, you people? You homeless people.
Just covering my bases.
We have clubs.
I
for
learned
that.
Some things with you want to express a politician your diversity on here.
I saw a guy picking up bottles in a carriage today, which I see a lot of those guys.
Yeah.
Those are hard workers.
Yeah, those are hustlers.
They're like on a bridge and they're in like, you know, on just curbs.
Yeah, they're not
picking up bottles.
Not begging.
No.
Those guys are working.
They're working for their nickels. Yeah. But in my head, all I kept thinking was, wow, I throw cans and bottles out and never recycle ever. Yeah. Imagine if this guy had my cans and bottles.
Yeah.
But I'm an asshole and throw them all out and
I
don't
recycle.
I throw
them in the trash, yeah. I'm so bad.
We're assholes. This guy would kill for our bags of empty bottles.
Because I see every Tuesday
Probably
when
literally.
I'm pulling out of my driveway, there is a person with a shopping cart going down my street. And I was like, dude, it's 22 degrees outside right now, and you're hustling my trash barrel.
I was going to say, not only do I not have a problem with that, I respect the hell out of
that. Yeah, go ahead.
Because they're not begging.
Not at all.
I almost want to like put it in a separate bag and just be like, here you go. Like, you don't have to dig through this one this week because it's cold.
Yeah, and they walk.
Absolutely.
They walk all, and they just determined this shit just to get every can they can. That's the way to be homeless. Or that's the way to be like.
But speaking on that, the girl did have an iPhone this week, the one next to my house. I'm like, I don't even have an iPhone. How do you have one? Probably from that 5 cents.
I like you coming. You know, that's how you're home. That's how you be homeless.
That's how you fuck.
That's how you rock the homeless.
Yeah, be poor.
You're gonna be homeless. Do it right.
Do it right. Get the cans.
Yeah, that's a real can-do attitude. You see what I did there?
I see what you did.
See what I
Make sure you don't bottle up your emotions.
Hey, nice.
Speaking
that was
of
awful.
Speaking of Fall River and the homeless people. Does anyone drive by the Watupa Pond? Not like the good Watupa protected pond, but like the other one.
Where's that?
I actually, we work on.
Oh, you guys work on the Watupa Pond.
Yeah.
There is now a new homeless community in the wood, the small patch of woods surrounding the Watapa Pond. Right where you guys work, yeah.
Wait a sec. Is that like, there are people that kind of hang underneath the bike trail bridge. You know, the new Kukusei
one? Yeah, it's the same crew. But I've been, if you drive by there, if you take
You've been profiling them?
Yeah. What do you mean?
I've been hunting the homeless. New show on Fox. But if you take the ramp off the highway towards like where you guys work, you can see they've built like a shanty town.
Okay, he's got nothing. Have you seen the one in New Bedford?
Like a shanty town? Homeless shanty town?
Bro. Please tell me somebody. I know the listeners have seen it.
I don't go to New Bedford.
I was looking for houses when I was house hunting, and I went to New Bedford for one to check one out. And as I came off the high, it's like Westport or New Bedford. Somebody could probably comment and know. This motherfucker is so determined. He's got a village that he created for himself. He has lights, like Christmas lights. And he lives. It's right when you're like coming off an exit. And it's those woods. Dude, it's you look and you go, what is going on? He built his own little community, just him. He's got all the shelter you need. He's got lights. I wish somebody would comment and tell me where the fuck it is. It's incredible because I drove by it and I was with Brandon, my friend Brandon. I'm like, dude, what is that? He goes, you don't know about this? He's like, that dude, he has a bike and he puts like a fucking wagon on it.
A bicycle, right?
Like a bicycle, yeah. And he has like a some kind of wagon he attaches to it to go and places and put stuff, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And dude, it's incredible. I wish I knew where it was because I.
Now, is that legal?
See, it's not supposed to be, but that particular
dude, just does it so good that nobody's gonna stop him.
Yep, they're like, dude, you're not. He don't bother anyone.
Yeah,
and it's really isolated from any houses. You know what I mean? It's like off the highway, and. Dude, it honestly looks badass. It's like, holy shit, dude.
How cool. Man cave.
Yeah, big time,
if I had thought of it sooner, I would like,
be homeless.
We could try to.
You could still
homeless.
Do it, Joe.
Yeah.
Don't worry.
Try to have someone, like one of those people on the show.
Yeah.
Those people.
Yeah.
On the show. And then after, like when they go to leave the show, we surprise them with something.
Like a house.
Get them like a gift card. Just like, you know what I mean? Like we said, hey, come on the show. Tell us about your life. And they leave here with like $100 for McDonald's.
I don't know. From what I've learned, and I learned this.
I wouldn't give
them straight
cash.
I believe the movie was Home Alone, where they don't want your handouts.
I've watched Home Alone, and I'm totally
really
lost.
Didn't the pigeon lady not want anything?
That's Home Alone 2, first of all, lost in New York.
Imagine if she was like, Kevin, I don't want that fucking turtle dove. Get that away from me.
I thought you were talking about the Wet Bandits.
Yeah, me too.
Because they were like homeless too. They want to take your stuff.
Yeah,
is that what you're saying?
Take your stuff. They
lived in a van.
Sticky Bandits.
Part two, they were sticky bandits. Yeah, part two, they were sticky bandits.
Oh, okay.
Part one,
I'm not
the
only one who's got this stuff confused, okay?
No, I know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the pigeon lady.
Okay. All right.
Wait, is Jeff, I don't think that mic is even on at all.
I don't.
Because I'll take
it a little. He has to talk really close. Go, try it again.
I was saying.
Yeah, I
can hear
now. Listen to him without headphones. I can hear him much better.
Yeah no shit. Because the mic's up.
He's in the same room.
He's got the homeless guy mic.
Okay. That's from Home Alone 2, that mic.
This is what we're going to give the good guy.
It might be from Home Alone 3.
Jeff's talking into a talk boy. It's not even a microphone.
Hey, by the way, in Home Alone, did it ever this used to bother the shit out of me when he would leave the water on. And you know,
when the Wet Bandits
would
do that.
That was
their calling card.
I was like, fuck, dude. Like, this is
so rude.
It's going to. I was so worried about
hot water.
I was so worried about the wasting water as a kid.
What's crazy is that would get them more jail time. So they would be smart not to do it in case they were caught. It would give them less jail time. You don't just destroy someone's property.
By the way, I just got a text message. It's exit 10 in Westport.
Exit 10 in Westport.
That's where that homeless dude is. And it's fucking incredible.
I'm going.
It's a I swear to God.
Like people go out searching for Christmas lights.
Exactly.
I'm going.
I was gonna say this isn't Lost in Life.
Dude, it's a village, bro. It looks like a fucking village. The guy has just dedicated his time to just building.
Well, Harry's got a lot of time.
What are you guys doing this weekend? Let's take the kids to the
homeless
exit 10.
Guy off.
Hey kids, hope you don't get eaten.
Lock the doors. Keep your windows up.
You might get robbed.
That's an interesting phenomenon. And you can see it right here in Fall River. Like you have a city, you have a population, a community, and like kind of in the margins and the nooks and the crannies of that community, a whole like secondary population springs up of drug addicts, of the mentally ill, and they kind of make their own housing, you know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they kind of exist like in these weird spaces and spots. Like, for example, the Fall River Bike Trail.
Yeah, which, by the way, that trail is fucking awesome. I can't wait till it's connected.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Okay, so we did the Fall River Bike Trail.
Yeah.
Joe and I and our friend Tori this past summer.
Yeah.
That was once just a railroad track. And on that railroad track was the Fall River homeless population. They lived in there because it wasn't developed and it was out of the way and it was a safe spot kind of in the woods. Mm-hmm. And then they made the bike trail and now those people kind of all got displaced. So now you kind of see new spots all throughout the city of homeless people.
Yep. Now, do the homeless people still hang under that bridge like now?
They still, from what I understand, because Kirby,
probably don't.
Kirby was joking earlier about like, let's go find some homeless people. I seriously will kind of like, I'll ride that trail. I hike that trail. Yeah. And I'm kind of
totally down for that.
I'm kind of like, what is that guy who got killed by a stingray?
Oh, the animal. Oh, yeah. Crocodile hunter.
Crocodile hunter. I kind of do that with homeless people.
Irving?
Jeff's giving up on the mic. He's like, fuck it.
Just speak Steve for
Irwin.
Me.
Steve Irwin. I'm kind of the Steve Irwin of Fall River homeless people because like I do that trail and I follow the tracks and
as in you want to look for them or you want to help them? Because I'm not sure which one Steve Irwin
I don't want to help them. I just want to kind of
explain it.
Yeah,
this here has had the same knitted hat for 12 years.
By the way, it's not easy to get like towards that area. Like you have to go. We had to jump over like this rusty barbed wire.
Oh, with your bikes?
Carry our bikes over this like dirt trail and barbed wire. It was kind of a struggle to get through.
It was like a tough mutter.
It was. Except very dangerous.
Yeah.
The Fall River Bike Trail is actually a training spot for the tough mutter.
Well, if you take a left or right off the Fall River Bike Trail, you're going to dip into one of these homeless communities. Because they're not too far like in the woods off those trails.
Gotcha.
And every once in a while, they will eat a cyclist. So... if any cyclists are listening, be wary on that.
They are cannibalistic.
Yeah, they will eat you alive.
I wanted to actually share something really quick. Last night I was feeling like kind of like shit, and some dude who's he watches the podcast. I'm not gonna name his name because I'm gonna tell his story real quick. He watched a podcast and he was like, "Yo, I heard about your story, like the story about what happened to your dick, man. Like that's crazy." He's like, "How you been?" I'm like, "I've been like depressed lately. I've been having some issues." He's like, "I can cheer you up," and I swear to God, it was the first time I laughed all day. I don't know if it's going to be that funny on the air, but when I read what this kid wrote me, I laughed my ass off. He goes, "I got something embarrassing." He said, "I used to do a lot of ecstasy and hit the clubs really hard. The drugs made me feel super amazing."
Good start, yeah.
That's why I'm already like, all right.
I'm intrigued.
I know. He said, "The drugs made me feel super amazing, but the problem is I couldn't get hard while I was on ecstasy," which I didn't know. I thought that actually like improved it.
I had that.
Certain
drugs same
have,
issue.
Have opposite effects.
Okay. So he said, "I used to eat these pills called Stamina RX. And that's supposed to give you a boner, I guess.
Sounds like a gas station.
I was
boner.
Just yes, gonna say dude. That sounds like it's sold at Shell.
He got it. Yep. I just saw that Shell while buying Newports, dude. So, thank you, dear. That's good. Oh yeah. Okay. Pouring that wine, girl. Oh sorry. So I used to eat these pills called Stamina X, kind of like over-the-counter Viagra. Yes. So, yes, you got it probably from Shell.
Gas station boner pills.
Definitely. So one night.
I didn't know gas station sold that. Yeah.
The reason that this is hilarious is because I believe this kid, and this is why this is insane. So one night I brought this girl home and was smashing for hours, probably legit like 3 or 4 hours I couldn't bust a nut. He goes, "I put my everything into it. My whole body tensed up and shit. Finally, after almost having a heart attack, I just let go. I immediately grabbed the plastic grocery bag on the side of my bed and started puking in it." So the kid fucked so bad that he just like got like...
Oh, that sounds like running a marathon.
If it couldn't
and then
come out one
off.
End,
yes.
It's going to come out the other.
Yeah. Oh. So
he was working so hard that his
dude.
Body failed him.
He threw He was working hot. Hey, so he goes...
What happened to the girl?
Check this out. He said...
I want to know.
I need to know what happened to the girl.
I'm just reading what he told me. "I immediately grabbed the plastic grocery bag..." This just gets better and better. "On the side of my bed and started puking in it. The bag had a hole in it. So I opened my door and tried running downstairs to the bathroom, slipped and fell down the stairs in my own puke.
I've done that.
He goes, "I get up to run into the bathroom. Toilet seat was down, puked all over the floor." He goes, "I slipped again and sliced my foot open on the strip that connects the tile to the rug."
Ooh, ouch.
So here I was laying in my own puke, slice on my foot, burning like a bastard from the acid in my puke. Like, the puke got in his...
Oh, the puke got in... He rubbed the puke in his own cuts.
No, like, the best part is his last thing. He goes, "And my dick was still hard as a motherfucker." I was like, "Bro, can I
what
appreciate it?"
What a guy.
I laughed my ass off.
His body failed him, but his boner didn't.
Nope. Yeah. And I just picture him like, and then puking, and it comes out the bag. Then he slips down the stairs on his own. The girl just...
No.
And he didn't say... Mm-hmm. The girl just must have been like, "I'm going to get my keys."
Yeah.
This is
gonna,
awkward.
I gotta go pick up my mom.
From the airport.
Always works.
That's a crazy story. And if that guy can get me some real ecstasy, that's Justin Crofton on Facebook. Hit me in the DMs. Thank you.
Slide right into his DM.
Is there even ecstasy anymore, or is it just Molly?
No. Dude, you know what?
I heard Molly makes you really happy.
Okay, let me clarify something. That's all horseshit, all right? Ecstasy, Molly, it's what it's supposed to be is pure MDMA.
Pure
That's
MDMA.
What the real drug is, yeah. Okay? I forget the actual scientific name behind that. Yep. But
MDMA is supposed to be like it's actually not that bad if it's pure MDMA.
Yeah, what you want is pure MDMA.
Ecstasy used to have, and I don't know if the Molly does too, have all sorts of crap.
Well, Ecstasy was supposed to be a street name for MDMA, which it wasn't. It was cut up with a bunch of other stuff.
Yes. So they put, sometimes I heard they put coke in a lot of it and all that.
Yeah. You had no idea what was in what you were taking.
Remember, wasn't some of them like called Mitsubishi's? Like that was one of the
Mitsubishi's. There footballs, moon rocks.
Oh my god,
footballs. Kitty cats.
It's
all supposed to be MDMA.
But it's all sorts of crap,
And that's the problem when you make something illegal, is people are still going to do it. You're not going to stop anyone from doing the drug. But the problem is now they're doing like these adulterate versions of the drug. So it's like maybe a little MDMA plus like maybe some GHB plus some maybe... drywall.
Baking soda.
No, they wouldn't waste cocaine in this.
That's true.
They're throwing in all types of funky
very
shit.
Very true.
Did you, you've tried Molly? Or?
Yeah, I tried it in a very weird way. I had for a while not done it. Just because, you know, doing a new drug, it's very, it produces a lot of anxiety. Because it's a whole new experience. You don't know what to expect. So that's very anxiety.
And everyone tells you, go in it, be calm. I'm like, I'm taking drugs.
Yeah.
How can I be calm?
Exactly. Yeah. You have no faith in it.
Right. It's a new drug. You don't know what to expect.
Right.
So for a while I waited. And then one night I had a bunch of friends. And they had kind of like a jam spot at a mill in Fall River. I won't say what the name of the mill
is. I went there once.
Was awesome.
I know exactly what you're
Kirby's,
talking to.
Kirby's
me,
been there.
It was awesome.
The horrifying experience of my entire life.
Awesome.
So they
great
were
place
like,
to be.
So like, hey, and I had been there a bunch of times. It was a really chill spot. And I felt comfortable there. So I was like, yeah, I'll definitely go. And I'll definitely do this ecstasy or whatever it is there. So,
whatever that is, put it in my nose.
Whatever. One thing I learned doing ayahuasca on the Amazon, as long as the setting is cool, I'm usually fine.
Yeah.
You know? So, last second, they were like, hey, they rented a spot like with another artist. She came. There's a big problem. We can't do it here. We're going to do it at a fucking Dunny's Bar in Fall River. I was like, all right, I'm 100% not doing it now because all I care about is being in a safe spot. I'm not going to be at the bar and do Molly for the first time or
Nothing ruins my high more than Dunny's.
Not somewhere you want to go and get fucking.
At any bar, you don't know what's going to go down. So I'm like, I'm done for the night. I'll drink, whatever. You guys can do it. I'll hang out. So I should have known a buddy of mine. I won't say his name.
What's it rhyme with?
He always does this and then says his name. Always.
It rhymes with Lip or Tazazic.
Yeah.
he was like... He was like, all right, we're not going to press you to do these drugs, but here's the Jack and Coke.
What? No, see, that's fucked up.
He roofied
dude.
You?
You know what's funny?
That's messed up.
Being roofied is the worst thing
I would
in the
have
world.
Laid a beating on him the next day.
Yeah, I don't tolerate that shit, dude.
Well,
because people
I've been
do
roofied
that.
Before. It's the worst experience in my life.
Wait, you got roofied like by some strange man?
Yeah, but they never took me home.
That's
nothing. Right. They roofied me and let me go.
Kirby's like, why didn't they rape me? I'm offended.
Well, that's the thing. I expected like, hey, you get roofied like you're supposed to like somebody you're getting taken to an alleyway, something
yeah,
like
what's
this.
Wrong with
no,
me?
This person let me drive home.
Yeah.
They roofied me and let me drive home.
That's called
chickened out at the last minute.
Yeah.
No, I think he did
it.
Must
have
been like,
the red
that's
hair.
The laziest rapist I've ever seen in my life. Like if you're gonna rape,
I know, dude.
Go for it.
What a horrible rapist. He's like, it's 1 a.m, man. What are you going to do? He's like, well, I roofed that bitch over there, but dude, Wendy's is like right there. So
left me out of commission for 72 hours.
This was definitely Scott or Joe. They went to fucking get fast food.
Yeah, we forgot about it. We were like, and we're like on our way home, like eating, and we're like,
fuck.
I feel like I'm forgetting something.
I would have totally taken that as an insult, too. It's like, you went through the trouble of
roofing
me.
To be honest, I was a little like, okay, so why do you roofie me? Just so you can watch? Did you follow me home at least? Like, did you see me like after my one margarita?
I still have my wallet
home, and I realized that like, oh no, I have no idea where I am. Oh, you're 3 feet away from your house. My mother, I was still living with my mother at the time. She finds me half on the couch, half on the ground. What are you doing? I'm like, Mom, I only had one margarita, I swear.
And they, she's they, like, didn't, yeah, even, right. They didn't even take your debit card?
Yeah.
What a bunch of losers. Hey, you know what? I don't feel bad for you because Joe and I went to a Catholic school for 8 years and we never got raped by any priest.
I went to Catholic school for more than 8 years.
Speak for yourself.
Yep.
But, speak for yourself.
Don't tell me you had some.
Let's just say I got to second base with Father Father something.
Who should not be named.
He's like, I'll show you the body of Christ, you feel me? On the back.
You want the bread and the blood? Is that what you want?
Yeah, it's the blood of Christ tastes good.
Father, I'll give you that bread and blood right now.
I was the only student to talk dirty to priests. They couldn't handle it. And they were like, I don't want to rape this kid.
Yeah, with Joe, they were like, whoa, slow down.
But sorry, we cut you off. How's it feel, by the way? Sucks, huh?
Well,
interruption
no.
number one for Justin.
Well, my friend slipped me some, allegedly, it was a Molly or ecstasy, which I don't think it was. To me, it just felt like kind of speed. I don't think it was real.
Yeah.
Ecstasy
didn't knock you out at all.
It just felt like I was on speed, you know? It just felt like I was kind of like
messy.
Were
you like super happy?
No, I was just kind of like very speedy, and it was supposed to be, you know. If you listen to any drug dealer, every drug dealer is going to tell you, and this is the problem with when drugs are legal, because you're going to do them anyway. But every drug dealer will tell you, like, oh, this is the pure shit, bro. They have to say bro, by the way, after every whatever bullshit they tell you.
Yeah.
And this was just like trucker speed, you know?
Right.
I'm on speed. This is not, I'm not feeling any joy. I'm not feeling any happiness.
Well, I don't do many drugs at all because I don't trust my mind. I got a very, like, I can break down easy, so that's why I'm scared to do mushrooms, as we've talked about. I did do Molly once, which I don't know why I did it, but.
You liked it, though, didn't
I
you?
I loved it, yeah.
It was a positive.
It was super cool, yeah. I luckily got a good vibe. It was me, my friend Ryan Paul, and a good friend, shout out Kate Chase, who's living in South Carolina now. And now we're at, we went to like IPC, which is like the worst bar in New England.
The ultimate dive bar.
The ultimate dive bar.
I can't talk shit.
I've had a lot of fun at that place. I shouldn't say that.
Have you ever
seen
a single attractive woman there that you didn't personally bring?
No.
No, never.
No, it's like you or Corey had said, Dick Tracy villains.
Yep.
It's just all.
And to get there is like you take a left on the street. That one's a one-way, so don't go down there. Don't park next to the yellow house. You will get shot.
Yeah, that's true. There's they don't let you. Yeah, you can't come out. You got to be quiet when you're outside because the neighbor.
Every woman there looks like someone put a wig on a walrus. No joke.
There's six Vavos that live in the surrounding areas. Please do not be loud. They will come out with their brooms.
It's rough, dude. It's rough. So I'm there. So obviously I need some Molly.
Absolutely.
To survive the night.
So I was a little nervous about taking it because I don't take many drugs like that. I can't smoke without getting like a panic attack. But I was like, I'm drinking. Fuck it. So we took it and went to my apartment. Now it's now like 2:33 in the morning. I'm with Ryan Paul, one of my best friends, and Kate Chase, also one of my best friends, which at that point, if I wasn't on anything, I'd be like, this is the worst night ever. Like, what are we doing? Sit in my apartment. TV wasn't on, nothing. On this shit, everything was just so cool. Like, when you have anxiety and depression, it's all like negative vibes. Mm-hmm. This shit was all positive. So I would like charge my phone and it was positive. I was like, I'm gonna charge my phone. Like,
fuck yeah.
It's going
the fuck out of my phone.
My phone's about to go to 100.
Now it's in the green.
100%.
It's like that. It's like euphoric. It's just like, man, the electricity's going in here and charging my phone.
But you have to start yourself in a positive attitude because my one mushroom experience was.
Mushrooms is different.
That's different.
No.
It's different
Molly seems to emphasize the positive.
See, mushrooms is that's why I'm scared to take it, even though
I had a very bad experience and I'll never do it again.
See, that's what I'm scared of. I'm scared to lose my mind. I've wanted to do it with Justin. And just
you have to be in your comfort zone. That's the thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, but we'll get to this later. I'm curious to hear her setting her setting of that trip.
Come right. I just told her to come for some reason. I'm
come, Kirby, come.
I'm not ready, Scotty.
On command.
That's what I tell every woman I'm having sex with. Please come. Come on. Won't you come?
Kirby needs to be warmed up.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Did you come? How about now? Did you come?
Imagine if there was a woman who come on command. Come now, woman.
Okay.
But I wanted to.
why does coming always end with a fart sound? Like I'm gonna come. Like if you're
yeah, d-
just the guy.
I'm just wondering.
Dude, it's a queef, kid. Fuck, bro.
But no. So the only way I explained Molly and my one experience was after that we were just having such a blast. I don't even think the TV was on. We were just having a blast, laughing and talking in my kitchen. And Ryan's like, dude, my socks are dirty. And I was like, let me see. And picture this in a normal setting. You'd be like, I don't give a fuck if your socks are dirty. Go home, dude. I want to go to bed.
Or like, what the fuck? Why are you talking about your socks?
I'm like, let me see your socks. I'm like, they are dirty. I'm like, guess what, bro?
I got a washing machine.
Nope. I'm like, take your socks off. I got a drawer full of socks.
Fuck yes.
I'm like, dude, I got ankle socks. I got knee socks. I got everything you need. And Ryan was like, let me see. It was just so like fucking. You're just happy, you know.
And
what I mean?
And you gave him new socks, and he was fucking jazzed,
dude.
Right?
He was like, "This is yeah." And that's how I describe it, dude. Yeah,
these are the freshest socks I've ever put on my feet.
It's like
oh my god,
pair
it feels
of
so
new
good.
Socks.
Yeah, it's crazy.
God, what kind of fabric soft you use? Oh my god, it smells so good.
I'm gonna eat your socks, Ryan. Why are you eating my socks? That's weird.
I had a very similar experience recently. I'm sorry. Okay, let's go, Kirby. Next.
I want to hear her.
Each of us has a different
situation.
Each of us have a. Has a different drug story.
Yeah.
Scott's Molly.
Yep.
Kirby's shrooms. I'm cocaine.
Oh, all right.
Okay. Oh. Hey, we'll go around.
So while she's going, can you get the
I'll
one?
I'll do cocaine while she tells her story.
Yeah. Get me a line real quick.
Save me some.
A wine.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just
I wanna
kidding.
This is, and this is why, Kirby, I'm scared to do mushrooms too because I have such a fragile brain. I feel like I can lose it easy.
Yeah. So
this guy's brain's made of porcelain. Go ahead.
Yeah. I was told that like I knew how I needed to go into the situation. You need to be in a positive attitude. You need to be in a situation you're comfortable with. So I'm there. There's these mushrooms. They don't look like real mushrooms, by the way, in case anyone's never seen me. I was at my apartment at the time, which was a house, actually. So I was in the garage of my house at that time.
And who you with?
My boyfriend at the time and two of his friends.
So I was sort of comfortable because you're your boyfriend.
But I had none of my friends with me.
Yeah.
So it was his friends, which I was comfortable with, but they're not my friends.
Yeah, and
they're,
I don't know that a garage.
You don't know them at all.
No, I do know them.
Okay, a little bit.
But not like
no,
super
we're cordial
with them.
With them, but it's not my boys, it's not my girls, right, like nothing like that.
Strike one.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Exactly. So
Justin knows a lot about the psychedelic stuff.
And I'm saying strictly, okay, these shriveled up, disgusting looking things.
Penises, yep.
They're disgusting looking and they're disgusting tasting. But I was like, listen, you guys can go out. Like they were planning on going to a bonfire or everything. I was like, that's fine. If I'm going to take these, I want to go downstairs and I want to watch Alice in Wonderland by myself.
That sounds...
Whether it be by myself or whether it be
no,
someone...
Justin said no.
Strike two.
Okay, well, I didn't do that anyways, Justin. So they're like, no, you need to come with us. You need to come with us. Okay, I eat these stupid-ass mushrooms. Get in the car. All right, I'm fine. Next thing I remember is we're sitting by the bonfire. We're at a friend's house, and his girlfriend just happens to be pregnant. And she's in the house secluding herself. So I decided it's a good idea to tell him what a douchebag he is for having a bonfire and leaving his girlfriend inside.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, that one didn't end good.
Yeah.
Fast forward to about an hour later. I'm assuming. I'm taking the time. I have no
so
idea.
So now you're high.
Oh,
on
I am done. And I don't realize that I'm done because all it is, it really intensifies what you're actually thinking. It doesn't, I wouldn't say it's psychedelic. I didn't see shit. I didn't, nothing like that. It kind of just intensifies the moment that you're in.
Okay.
So I flipped out on him for leaving his pregnant girlfriend inside for whatever reason. I didn't even like her.
Let me Justin, would I be correct in saying when you're on mushrooms and anything negative happens, that's
it
where
you
stop
down
to.
Right away.
That's why you, set and setting are so important.
Exactly.
Those are the two things.
And that was my thing going into it, is I want to be comfortable, whether it be in my own house or whether it be with people that I'm comfortable with.
But the minute it gets negative, it's impossible to get out of that?
I don't. It only went downhill for me.
Gotcha.
So I decided that I was going to walk away from the situation. So I go to my friend's car that I came in, sit in the car for a few minutes. Nope, not okay. And then the person's house that we're at is in Dartmouth in the boonies. So I decide I'm going to walk down the street. So I'm walking down the street by myself.
For a casual stroll.
Jesus. Casual stroll. It's probably 12:30, 1 o'clock in the morning in Dartmouth.
High on shrooms.
I have no idea where I am. Just walking down the street because I hate everyone at this point. Somebody left their pregnant girlfriend inside, and that was the end of it for me.
That was the straw that broke the camel's back.
That was it for me. I told him what a terrible person he was and walked away. Walking down the street, come back. Still can't get out of it. And now at this point, because I have anxiety too, so when I start realizing that I'm not in control of my body, because
yeah, that's my issue too. Yeah,
if I can't control my body, whether it be from doing drugs or drinking, it's bad. Like
you lose it. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. I start to freak out. So I was like, need to leave now. No, not gonna leave. Okay, sat in the car by myself for must have been 17 hours. Probably only 15 minutes.
Right.
See, that's my problem with the, with like even, excuse me, like marijuana and like psychedelics. Is
time
I,
distortion.
I have, oh, no, but I'm saying I have a huge problem with not being in control of my own thoughts. I already have problems like that.
Yeah.
Like straight. You know what I mean?
You'll at least try a different drug. I personally don't even like to try like new shit.
Honestly, Joe, dude, I've done Molly. I've never done Coke. I've never done shrooms because I'm
like that.
I'm scared to lose the control. I'm a control freak. If I can't control my own, I already have, like I said, I already have, that's why I'm going through issues right now. I already have trouble controlling my own thoughts and emotions. And so like when I smoke just regular weed, which a lot of people get to chill out, but dude, I'm out of control and I'm just panic. So I can imagine how good a mushroom trip would be if I could be positive.
If you could let go.
Yeah, if you could just
push the stop button.
Yeah. Yeah.
You just, exactly. If you could let go of control.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yes. You don't trust that, what's going to happen.
Right. And of course not. And the thing is, Joe, is like a mushroom trip is anywhere from like 4 to 6 hours, right? I mean, even more maybe.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Or more, right, yeah. Depending on how many you take.
So the fact that there's no stop button is a huge panic for me. And
but
that's
there's no stop button on, if you're talking about that type of thing, there's no stop button on anything, you're whether it be alcohol.
No, you're right.
Yeah. Anything of that nature.
Alcohol tends to calm me. I know a lot of people get...
I love alcohol.
Yeah, alcohol calms me down. But
we love alcohol.
But cheers. You're right, cheers. Though. You can't...
Cheers to depressants.
Yeah.
Amen.
The lack of control is tough for me. That's why one day... I'd like to try it, but I do fear losing my mind.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't have a good grip on that, so that's why. And I hear the stories about mushrooms, and it's so fucking fascinating because I'm big into the what's, you know, revealing the curtain and what's out there really. You know what I mean? What we only see and can sense. You know, I feel like the mushrooms give you a nice, if you can get in the right setting, you know, you can look at things differently. And I've heard of people looking at just like a flower and crying. Because they just
that's
never.
That's what I wanted to go into as.
But instead, you're walking back and forth, yelling at people for leaving.
Well, you need the right set and
setting. Exactly. And so, I wish I was in the correct setting because I ended up literally because I was 20 something at the time, early 20s, piss poor. Yeah, I had a second bedroom in my apartment. All it has was a futon in it, a futon and a light switch. I ended up. That's it. Poor
that's
people.
One hell
problem.
Of a fucking.
Yeah, right. That was that was my spare room.
Dude, half the homeless.
I have kind of the same spare room, except with a lot more trash. And
exactly. Well, I didn't have enough shit to put in.
Like a futon and a light switch. Can we on the description of this podcast make sure we add that
a futon and a light switch.
Like half the homeless people would walk in there and be like, you know what, I'm gonna stay outside.
Yeah. This is
all bad. I ask in a relationship is just they have a futon and a light switch.
I mean, seriously, is it too much to
add? My criteria.
By the way, how is alcohol a depressant? Like, don't we typically have a good time when we have it? Like, when we're drinking a depressant, we're not depressed at all. Maybe it's the, like, once we're coming off of it.
I was just going to say, no, I think it has to do with the atmosphere as well.
Okay.
Well, they call it a depressant, but I think that is a description of what that does almost biologically. Like, I know it depresses certain aspects of your brain, certain functions, which may allow, like, more inhibition to be.
The potential for sadness is greater. Right.
Yeah, so they call it a depressant, but that doesn't necessarily mean... that you're depressed from drinking it.
Yeah.
Even it depresses certain functions.
Yeah, exactly. It's more, the word is kind of, it shouldn't use that word.
Yeah, it's like it's a medical term almost.
Right.
Even if I'm alone, slightly sad, drinking wine,
you're having a
great
time.
No, I agree.
Yeah, great
a good time.
I'll tell you one thing though, for people who do have anxiety and depression.
Makes it worse.
In the morning. So I'm not talking about a hangover.
Is this just with you or do you notice this amongst other people that struggle with
I'll
it.
Guarantee you anybody with severe anxiety problems will tell you that after a night of drinking they are horrific. I just know a lot of people who have it.
The morning.
Yeah, the mornings are tough. Mornings suck for me anyway, but it's something to do with the alcohol. And again, I'm not talking about the physical hangover. But
you won't leave the bed.
It's tough, yeah. Yeah. But so that's why like I'm having, this is like my second glass of wine. I'm going to go eat. I'm not going to, I'm in a bad state. The fact that I'm here right now, dude.
This is how different we are. Like he's
we
on a second glass
you.
Of wine. We're on our third and fourth. Hey. And we're likely
fifth,
we'll
six,
be a fifth or
sixth
six, or seventh.
Justin had a whole glass of wine before we even and I was like,
he's like, guys, don't go live yet. I need to fill my
guys,
wine glass.
I was drinking pre-show at my house.
You drank that in like less than 5 minutes. You kind of just shot it.
This is fruit.
The wine.
This is
not even thinking.
Jeff,
this is fruit juice.
What are we at time-wise?
We got about 15 minutes left.
All right. I wanted to touch on something quick. Joe saw me this weekend in a weird state of mind, huh?
I did.
I wanted to talk quickly about
that.
I'm
going to be honest. I was a little... It shook me a little.
Yeah, it was tough.
To see the severity of the situation. But
yeah.
But go on. I'll let you explain.
Oh, well, I've had a tough situation ever since that whole dick issue. It kind of opened up a can of worms with my anxiety and stuff, but... it's never been, my anxiety and depression has been like awful lately, but Joe saw me and probably never saw me like that before, huh?
I will say when you were younger and struggling with depression, I used to see you at the Belmont not wanting to talk to anyone with a chair pointed at the corner of a room.
Yeah.
And you were just like, fuck people. I'm going to stare at this wall and have a great conversation with this wall.
Now see, here's the difference. I remember exactly the night you're talking about.
Yeah.
I used to have like, I was more miserable, and I liked being miserable. It made me feel better to be like, I don't want attention. I want to be in the corner and be miserable.
That was the extent that I saw, but this most recent, I was like, wow, this is real.
Yeah.
And I mean, I knew depression was real, but there's still a lot of people out there that are just like, kids always fucking miserable.
Yeah. Guy, like, just be happy, bro.
Just
fucking be happy,
smile.
Guy.
Is
I can't
so
even,
hot?
Dude. I can't even laugh at that because that bothers me so much.
No, I know.
It sucks.
I can
dude.
Imagine.
I'm quoting that from like when I've been depressed and people have said that to me, and it's like you fucking numbskull.
Well, like we've talked about. Like I said before, I hate that they use the word depression, anxiety. It's too basic.
Right.
They need like a technical term because people hear depressed and they think, "Well, you're sad." So what happened this
guy,
weekend?
I've been sad. My fucking goldfish died one time.
I got anxiety, yeah. This is what I'll explain, anxiety, for what I have, the way I have it. This has happened to me the last couple weeks. This is going to freak you out, dude, but this is why he saw me. I lost it in front of him and my mother. I just lost it. Picture you're sending a text message to somebody, all right? Curb, you're sending a text message of your boobs to somebody.
Okay.
Like a friend of yours, whatever. You send
practice
it.
On my
Wait.
Phone.
What? Watch. Send one to Justin. So you're sending it to a friend, and then for an instant you look and you're like, holy shit, I just sent this to the wrong person. Do you know that?
Yeah.
Do you know the feeling you get? It's mm-hmm. it's here. It's here, and it's a hot flash.
Seriously, send it though. I'm sorry.
But it's constant. It's like a constant like.
Bro.
Like, oh my God. Oh my God. Well,
like there's a weight on your chest.
Dude, I'm talking
but there's no reason to have this weight.
Yeah. That's the thing.
There's nothing to justify it.
No,
right. And that's where it becomes a problem is like if I was worried about sometimes it comes from worrying about stuff.
Yeah.
A lot of times it does. What happened this last couple weeks for me is that this is what freaked me out is that I had that pure panic. You know that instant hot flash panic?
Yeah.
24 hours a day.
Oof.
And when I say that, I'm not exaggerating. I was sitting there at work when this started on, and I've had this before in the past, but never this extreme. It was Tuesday. I will never forget this for the rest of my life. I was on Tuesday and I'm working and I'm like, I'm somehow getting through calls. I'm somehow doing work. And I looked over and a girl I work with, she's like my one of my best friends at work. She goes through this shit too, so I can talk to her. And I said, Steph, I said, dude, I don't know what's going on, but I've had that shit all morning. And it won't go away. And I'm starting to freak out. It happened for 2 days straight. Dude, 2 days of a pure panic, bro.
Yeah.
I'm not kidding you. And that will make you think, bro, I want to kill myself. Like, I literally I thought about it. I'm not kidding you. That's how bad it was. I had to go get...
it's a hell state.
Bro, it's unbelievable. And I had... What happens is there's ways and techniques, which I'm going to see a therapist actually this week. There's techniques that you can actually... But I'm like, there's something wrong with my body. I'm like, it's not my brain. Like, something's wrong with my body. Am I having a heart attack? And you wouldn't believe.
And you're feeling this primarily where in your body?
Stomach and chest.
Stomach and chest.
That's
okay.
Crazy.
So by Sunday, I had.
And it feels like what would you say? Pressure, weight, heaviness.
It's the butterflies. You know them butterflies?
Yep.
When you're, but it's the bad ones. So like I said, when you see that text message, like, oh my God, did I send my dick to my fucking mother? Like that instant.
Like a curdled milk
just
feeling.
Just a pure, and I was literally getting hot flashes and everything. And I'm like, something's going on with my body. And that drove me into, so I was like, something's wrong. I felt like I was dying. So I went to my mother's house and she's been like amazing. And I said, Ma, like, and I swear to God, dude, I said, I don't want to freak you out, but I need to be hospitalized right now. Mm-hmm. Like, that's how bad it was, bro. I was like, I need an IV with some kind of, I need to be sedated right now. And she's just, I got to give her credit. She just fucking, she knew it was the anxiety, but I didn't. And what I did was
she seems very experienced.
Dude,
she's dealt with it.
Yeah.
So I think she knew what to say to you.
She did, and she knows
any other
me.
Person would be like, hey, I gotta take this kid to the hospital.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I wanted to go because I didn't know what else to do. And when he saw me, he came over on a Sunday to my mother's house, and it had been a little bit better, but that day was the same thing, dude. It was all the whole day. I was trying to lay down in different like positions to kind of see. I didn't know what to do. And
so weird.
I lost it, dude. And it's a cry like you have never seen.
So we're
dude.
Watching football, right? Every like
what game?
I don't even remember, to be honest with you. It might have been the Pats game. Me and his mother are chit chatting. I'm kind of even joking with Scotty, like trying to get him to laugh. And then out of the blue, like you know, we're all happy. Out of the blue, breaks down.
Like a breakdown,
and,
bro.
And I didn't realize what was happening until like it was kind of quiet in that direction, and I was like. The fuck is going on? I looked and he lost it. He fucking lost it for no reason. And that's when I looked at it and I was like, this shit is real. Like,
yeah. It's so real.
Nobody just sits there and loses their mind for no reason.
Yeah. And like, it wasn't like a weep. Like, you know, when some girl cries because she can't find her keys and shit.
Right.
This was from the depths of my soul, just a panic stricken sob. And I cried in my mother's arms and it was fucking. It was awful, dude. And it honestly made me feel like for a half.
I was going to say, were you relieved after it happened?
For 30 minutes, absolutely. I was pretty good. Yeah.
Now, can you pinpoint the source of that agony or depression?
That's what I've been trying to do.
It's just all in here.
It's I think what happened was when the shit happened, when everybody heard the story about the penis thing, and I never got answers and all that, it brought the depression and anxiety back.
It started a domino effect almost.
Yeah, it almost like brought it to the surface, and now it can't get away. So... what I've done is done a lot more reading, and I am not alone, dude. There are people everywhere who have
not
the same
even
thing.
Close.
Yeah, there are people who go to the emergency room all the time, and because they think they're having a heart attack. So that gave me a little bit of comfort,
right.
Knowing that. Because I'm thinking, there's something going on in my body, and I'm about to die. Like that's how bad it was. So when I realized it was that, and I talked to I got a therapist that I'm seeing. I haven't seen her yet. The chick called me directly, like. Didn't have
she's
her fucking.
Like, here's what I do.
She goes, yeah. Listen to me. I've been specializing in anxiety for 30 years. I'm 50 something years old. She said, and I gave her like a 2-minute synopsis on what I was like, this is what's happening to me. She goes, yep. She goes, I'll give you tricks and tips on how to fix that. So and I've been a little better since then. So it is brain related. I have like psycho pills that I'm taking.
Mm-hmm.
Not now, but like to sleep. But I'm hoping to get back. But I'll just
now you
tell
say psycho pills. What are the effects of these pills?
Xanax is the highest Xanax you can give. This is Xanny bar. And
can you sell me some of those pills?
No.
you don't want to take those.
It comes in granola form.
He said Xanax. Yeah. Those are my favorite.
It's funny, though, because when he just
broke. No, they go in a cereal bowl and then I eat them with milk.
When he just broke down and like him and his mom are hugging each other, I said... who's going to turn on NFL Red Zone?
Joe's just in the corner like, all
right. My fantasy team is struggling, and I know.
I need 6 points from this wide receiver.
Yeah,
please change the channel, Sind.
Imagine how good that Snapchat would have been.
Oh, dude, my God. Dude.
Guys, this guy's just crying with his mom. Like, NFL Red Zone, guys.
well, you said Scott had an emotional breakdown. I thought the Giants were just having a bad game, and he was fucking losing it.
That's nothing new, Justin.
But like I said, what I've been doing is a little fighting. So
yeah.
Instead of, I tend to let it just overcome.
Take you, yeah.
I said, no, I'm going to work. I'm going to work. I went to work. I went to some holiday lunch. I wanted to blow fucking brains out, but I did it.
It's a distraction, though.
It does. It is. And I don't want to live like that. I don't want to distract myself. Yeah. I want to deal with it. But for now, you know. And I actually looked forward to the podcast for some reason. You know, everything's negative when I'm like this. So every thought, I'm literally like, today getting up just to eat something is negative.
Even wearing brighter colors usually gets your mood up. Like.
Shut the fuck up.
You look hot in that vest.
It's a little warm in here.
Well, let me ask this about your recent bout of depression. Can you pinpoint, obviously it was the issues that you were having, the medical issues, right? Was it thought related? Did it start with negative thinking and just kind of snowballed from there?
Okay, yes. So when I had the issue where no one could tell me what was wrong with my dick burning and all that shit, that what that does is it takes down like your wall of defense. Like I have a wall of defense, like I like to say, whereas when negative shit comes and I start to get anxiety, I have a wall that says, no. I'm not gonna
You mentally go, and I'm not gonna go down that road.
Yes, and I also have medicine that works as that block too.
Yep.
What happened was this wall broke down, and once that wall broke down, it's like you're imbalanced. So now that all that anxiety and stuff, it doesn't matter, Justin. Like everything's negative. I woke up today and just trying to figure out what to wear. I don't give a fuck what I just to figure out what to wear was stressing me out to the point where my fucking heart was exploding.
Right.
What do I eat? I have to eat something. Like everything is so difficult. It's fucking nuts. And all it is chemicals. Like your brain chemicals are fucked up. So instead of medication, what I'm trying to do is get to this therapist and fucking get through, because I'm not alone. I put a post up today and I did that because
props to you for doing that. It was as tough. Well, because that is a very hard thing to do.
Yeah, that's therapeutic
to tell
too.
People it is. That you have an issue.
Yeah, it's tough. It was tough because, you know, Carib, I had that written down for 4 days. Because
it is an issue, but it's not a bad issue. It's just something that happens in your life. And and to tell somebody else that, hey, this is what's going on with me is,
I think it helped a lot of people.
What courage that takes is unbelievable.
Yeah, for sure.
It took 4 days.
You don't get all those likes for no reason. No. Like people
get it.
They're like, yep.
No, people.
Yeah, because everyone deals with depression, but no one wants to talk about it.
I think that's
so when someone comes out and says it, everyone's like, fuck cool. Yeah.
It's a stigma that really, like, that's something I really back up, is that depression and anxiety is such a stigma that everyone pretends doesn't exist, but
it's huge. It is. It's big.
And the amount of people that actually go through it is really something that you should really pay attention to.
Absolutely. And I didn't.
Because you are not alone.
Absolutely.
Now, Scott, would you say the cause of depression is ultimately negative thinking? Is it ultimately, does it begin with thought?
That's a good question.
Or does the negative thinking cause an alteration in brain chemistry?
I believe it's chemical imbalance.
I do too.
I think it's negative thinking first, and that somehow causes, and I don't know if there is science behind this. Maybe there is. I think the negative thinking eventually causes a change in brain chemistry.
Okay,
which may be possible.
You're correct.
Yeah.
But it's not. You're correct in some cases. 100%. You're absolutely right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There are some cases like mine when this happened to me.
Where it just hits out of the blue. No negative thinking. Just
I was the happiest. Are we running out? By the way, what do we got?
We got like 5 minutes left.
All right. I'll go on this quick because I do want to do a quick freestyle.
Yeah.
I also want to do a shout out to the sponsors too.
Okay. So. Yeah. So I'm gonna wrap it up here. When I was 19 is when this happened. And, bro, I was the happiest kid in the world. I loved life. And it hit me for no reason.
It had nothing to do with your thinking patterns.
I never found out why. I don't know if it was because I lost faith in, like, God and started to realize.
Which would be a thinking pattern.
It would. But I don't know, Just.
But
like,
you can't remember.
This shit. I never knew. Even when I was 19, I was like, I remember one time I went home and I looked up and I was like, I was like, if you're there, like, just please help me. I don't want money. I want to find out what's wrong with my brain. So I do think it's chemistry.
Crisis.
I do think it's chemistry. Let's freestyle. Let's
shout out to our sponsors, Unique Customs.
Word.
Also, Pachico's Furniture and Phoenix Marketing. They are hiring still, correct?
They are.
Nice. Now, there was a drawing that's supposed to happen. Is that not happening?
I have no clue.
Okay.
Cool.
So there's no
I'm
drawing
right
happen.
Along.
You want to bust out a freestyle quick?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do freestyle.
We got three, four minutes left?
We have three and a half.
Let's fucking hurry up, huh? What we got? Let's just all go. One freestyle. All
right.
Can
we save each other?
Yeah, just jump in. We're going to do one and that's it.
Okay.
Well, yeah, we'll just bounce around. See what
Let me tell you, Jazel, which I practice his name multiple times.
Yeah, I tried to and I still fucked it up.
Jazel.
During the podcast while I'm watching Cooking My Pasta last week, I'm saying Jazel, Basil, Hazel, Jazel.
I tried the same thing.
Um, But since I wasn't on the podcast, I can tell you he was terrible and he did not freestyle at all.
Yeah, I'm going to be honest. I didn't give it a shot either.
Terrible.
Justin and I had, we tried
it. Scotty killed it.
You guys just wasted like
Scotty,
a minute
Scotty
and a half.
Tore, okay. Scotty tore it down. But real quick before the freestyle.
Throw the beat.
Kirby, you run to the mayor at the bar. He's like, yo, what's up? I'm trying to sling this mayoral dick. What do you do?
What do you do?
Is it Jaziel or Jazel telling me this?
Jazel.
Jazel like Basil.
Do you bang the mayor, yes or no?
Do you bang
the mayor? I'll
just put that beat on.
How tall is he?
Put the beat on.
I would say 5'6", 5'7".
No, no, no.
This bitch.
No, no.
What if he said, I'll give you $10,000 from the city?
Down.
What if he told you about the transitional docking plants that he has? Would that get you wet? Gets me wet.
Moist.
Moist.
Look.
All right, ready?
We're trying to get a beat.
Can I go first? Can I go first?
Yeah.
I don't
know. Justin,
I don't
go after, first.
But
you never offer.
Save me after three lines, though.
Oh, God.
All right.
Okay. Sorry. So we'll say... sound guy's trying to get his sound right. Shit.
Justin, are you going to watch this tomorrow and see if you remember any of it?
No, I will wait a few weeks first because I'm too embarrassed to watch it tomorrow.
The word to rhyme with is hobo because we were talking about all hobos.
Right. I got you.
Hobo.
Hobo.
That's a good
Is that okay? You want a different one?
All right, let me think about that.
If we can get the beat, I wonder what happened, Jeffy. If we have no beat, we'll just go. We'll go instrumental.
Oh, we got.
All right, ready?
No, it's not working.
Nope. All right, ready? Y'all ready?
Right.
Got it.
Got it.
Okay.
I'm waiting for a beat.
Do you want me to start?
Oh,
a beat?
Oh shit, shit!
I'm always waiting for.
Yo, start a beat.
Oh, don't make me rap to Kirby.
Got it.
Bullshit.
Oh, we got it.
Are you talking shit about my beat, Justin?
You don't like guys that are short,
right? All
right, I got you. Now I'm the Now I'm the
That dude at Diamond, he don't like no homo. And I can't stand every hobo, cause they're all fat like you eating every day. But you still wanna get in my pocket and me pay? Fuck that, man. Why are you pressing? Don't you know I got anxiety and depression? Shit, I'm on all sorts of medication. So much that I can't even get masturbation. It really sucks to be fucked up. But Justin's gonna take the mic, so shut up.
Whatever, bro, podcast, yo, we're the best. My man Scotty, damn, he's depressed. I'm looking over here at Kirby's Press. Fall River City, we're about to smoke cess.
Hey!
Marijuana facilities putting us to the test. I have no more rhymes.
I got you.
Scott, please save me.
Kirby, me and you, we're driving over to Braga. Then we go to CVS so I can get some Viagra. So my dick gets hard for 4 hours. Man, I can't understand these flowers. Kirby, save me, girl. I know you want to rap. And when you're done, girl, I'm going to clap.
Boy, keep clapping. I'm going to stay up rapping in this biz. Joey Justin, you know I'm going to stay cussing. And then I'll say fuck you and you too. Oh, wait, there's four of you now. Justin, Jeff, Joey, Scotty. Wow.
Hey, oh, shit.
That's the best I've ever done.
Yeah. Just about to jump in.
God damn it, Kirby. Your hair is so fiery. Hey, guys, look. It's Jaisal's diary.
Oh, come on,
read it. Because fuck it, he's the mayor. I don't even know what I'm saying. Next player.
He's Boom. A player.
Give Jeff that mic because you know who ends
Swing
it.
Swing around.
Jeff's got a line.
Oh, Jeff, give it to me. Give it to me.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's our show. One more message before we go. When you see the fat man with the ho, 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 Merry Christmas, y'all, from whatever, bro.
Oh! Oh, shit.
He did that with 1 second left.
Holy shit.
Killed it.
Wow.